leading us to the service on Easter Sunday, which is going to be a time of rejoicing. So just bear with me. We're going to go on a little bit of a trip. Since our kids, we like to time travel in KidVenture, we're actually going to time travel to church today. We're going to go back in time and see on some of these days. So the first thing, the message is going to basically be called The Last Words of Jesus, because we are going to wrap up on Good Friday when the crucifixion occurred. Let's take a look first at some of the prophecies that were given about the coming of Jesus. God's covenant with David. It says, "And your house and your kingdom shall be established before you. Your throne shall be established forever." What this is telling us is that God has promised that the kingdom of David, or the house of David, will share a kingdom forever. This particular verse is the focal point of all of the prophecies that were made about the coming Messiah. Everything is rooted within this first verse here. Also, this covenant with David, it's unconditional. There's no rules. God said he was going to do it, so you know what? God's going to do it. When God makes a promise, he's going to keep it. The ultimate fulfillment of this prophecy will be when the kingdom of Christ is here. Because Jesus, remember, was born of the tribe of Judah and is of the house of David. That is how that kingdom is going to reign forever. The prophecy of the coming of Christ. It says, "Therefore the Lord himself will bring you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." In Matthew 1:23, we can read this as the prophecy of the foretelling of the Virgin Mary, who in fact brought forth a son, and his name was Emmanuel. Emmanuel means what? God with us. Jesus is God with us in the fullest sense. Prophecy was fulfilled. The death of Christ. "For dogs have surrounded me. The congregation of the wicked has enclosed me. They pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They look and stare at me. They divide my garments among them. And for my clothing, they cast lots." This is telling us that the mockers and the non-believers are going to surround him. It tells us that they're going to pierce the Messiah's hands and feet. They are going to look and stare at him on the cross. They're going to divide his garments. Is it easy to see how this prophecy was fulfilled? You had the trial. You had the cross. You had the mockers that surrounded him on the cross and made fun of him, telling him to bring himself down if he's the Son of God. You had the Roman soldiers who was out there casting lots for his clothing. Again, the prophecy in this case here was fulfilled. Now, there was one that was up there. It should have been a prophecy of Messiah entering Jerusalem. Go back up one. There we go. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." The coming king is the messianic king, which is Jesus. So this is prophesizing that the king will enter Jerusalem. And what happened today on Palm Sunday? The king entered Jerusalem. It says that he is coming having, that he is just and having salvation. Just and having salvation, that is the divine standard of morality and ethics. Yes, morality and ethics. Thank you back there. Yeah, I lost my train of thought there for a second. I'm trying to read ahead. Yeah, so morality and ethics. Jesus was riding a donkey. What is the donkey? The donkey is the symbol of peace. The horse is a symbol of war. The donkey is a symbol of peace. So Jesus was on the donkey. Also, the donkey was the royal mount of another king in the past before Jesus, and that was King David. King David's royal mount also was a donkey. Okay, let's go on up to where Jesus is in the synagogue. then we're going to go back in time and see what happened after this point here, because this is where things started going the other way for Jesus. This is where we wind up at the very end here. Now, in the synagogue, Jesus went in and opened the scroll to Isaiah. Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3. This is the scripture that he read. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those." What Isaiah is doing, he's prophetically for the Messiah. So when the Messiah reads this, he's about to reveal him to who he is. He basically will say that the Lord has appointed him, anointed him, and empowered him as the Messiah. He will preach good tidings to the poor, because poor makes us impoverished. He will heal the brokenhearted, because sin will break the heart. He will proclaim liberty and open the prison doors, because sin makes us captives. He continues to read, "To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn." The Messiah will proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, because sin oppresses us. He will tell us that there will be a day of vengeance of God where we will have to pay for our sins, because sin is a crime that must be punished. So he's telling us we need to be careful. He will also comfort all who mourn, because sin brings us grief. He continues to read, "To console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Again, he's telling us that the Messiah will comfort those who mourn. He will bring beauty from the ashes of despair. He will an oil of joy and a garment of praise to lift us out of a spirit of heaviness. He will bring God's glory, God's people back to glory. They will call them strong and beautiful and trees of righteousness. Us as God's people, when people look at us, they will see that we have been planted by God. They will look at us and call us strong and beautiful. Okay. Now, once Jesus read the passages, at that time, the rabbi would close the scroll and go sit down. And people were waiting to hear his interpretation of what he read. After he sat down, everybody was on pins and needles to see what he was going to say. And he said, "Today, your ears have heard, this prophecy is fulfilled." What do you think the people in the synagogue did? Were they happy? No, not at all. They was very upset, asking him, who did he think he was to claim himself as the Messiah? They were calling him blasphemer. They wanted to take him out and stone him. I don't think that was going to happen. Jesus, as a matter of fact, what was kind of fascinating when you read the story is Jesus actually walked through the synagogue and nobody laid a hand on him. Nobody touched him. So again, he was proclaiming himself as the Messiah. A lot of people were upset with that. And from this point on, Jesus went out to do his ministry. And of course, we know what happened as the Pharisees got more and more upset with him. They wound up having him crucified. Okay, what we're going to do, we're going to now travel back in time. The kids know how to do this. They know how to get ourselves ready. We did our praise this morning, so we got our ship all powered up and ready to go. So let's see if our flight crew is ready to take us back in time. About this, what do you think? Do you trust these folks? We might, I'm not sure. Yeah, aliens, yeah, there you go. Guy with the beard especially, I don't know about him. Boy, it's hard to believe how young Isaac was there, isn't it? Yeah. All right, so what we're going to do, we're going to sit back, we're going to relax, we're going to buckle up our seatbelts, and we're going to head back in time. Here we go. All right, here we are. We are now standing outside the gates of Jerusalem as Jesus enters through the gate. This is Palm Sunday. The crowd is gathered. The people are laying down clothes in front of Jesus as he's walking or riding on the donkey. People are waving palm branches. They're yelling, "Blessed is the King who is coming in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven, glory to the..." What do you think the Pharisees were doing as the people were crying this out? They weren't very happy. If you remember from a past little message I did, Jesus and the Pharisees seemed to have a little bit of heartburn with each other here. Well, now that heartburn was getting even bigger because now they saw all these people praising Jesus. They told him, "Make these people stop." And Jesus told them bluntly, "If I should make them stop shouting, the rocks would now cry out as well." Me being the joker I am, I would have said, "Okay, everybody quiet. Let's listen to the rocks." But no, the people continue to praise Jesus. And of course, as we were saying in the song, and as Pastor Steve had mentioned, they're out, "Hosanna to the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest," who their Lord and Savior was entering the city. We're now going to move up forward a couple of days to Good Friday. And this is where the meat of the message actually comes in. We're going to be just outside the gates of Jerusalem at a place called Golgotha. And if you look at this next picture here, Golgotha is called Place of the Skull. Can you see the skull in the picture? At the very bottom of the rock, you can see the two holes. That is the eyes. If you look right below that, you can see the nose. It's pretty clear why they called this place the skull. Okay, in the distance, there's a noise. We can see a crowd coming up towards us. As we see that there's a man. He's beaten and bruised and bloody, and he's bent down under the weight of this cross. The closer he gets, we can see that it is Jesus. Our hearts break. Can you imagine seeing a sight like this? And I'm sure it was a lot worse than what this picture's showing here. The heart would just break over his suffering, knowing what he was about to go through. But the one thing about this is that his suffering was only just beginning. It was about to get a lot worse. It's the third hour, or 9 a.m. in the morning, as Jesus is nailed to the cross. Now, as he's being nailed to the cross, Jesus actually offers up a prayer. And he says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Here is Jesus being nailed to a cross, and he's more concerned about others than he is of himself, even at this time. So that tells you what kind of person he is, not concerned at all about himself. Now, when Jesus says, "Father, forgive them," who is he asking forgiveness for? Is it the Jews? Is it the Roman soldiers? Or is it all mankind that he is asking for forgiveness? We won't know until we actually meet him and say, "Who for forgiveness?" A lot of folks believe it is all mankind that they was asking. But again, forgive them because he did forgive us. So yes, I would kind of agree with that. With this, we see Jesus as an interceder for others because he's always concerned about others and not just himself. Isaiah 53:12 says, "There will divide him a portion with the great and shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors." With that first saying, prophecy was fulfilled. Now, Jesus was placed on a cross between two criminals. Now, we know with the criminals that one of the criminals actually mocked him and was telling him, "If you're the Son of God, bring yourself down and save us with you." So not only was the crowd telling him to bring himself down or have Elijah come and save him, but even the criminal was making fun of him. Even the criminal up there hanging on a cross. But the other one said, you know, he asked Jesus for forgiveness. And he said, "Are you not afraid of God? We have committed a crime. We are getting our just punishment, but this man has done nothing. And the criminal asks Jesus to please forgive him and take him to paradise with him. Jesus, showing that he can forgive, basically said, assuredly, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise. Jesus said today he will be with him in paradise in a few hours after they have died. Not in some future time, but that day. Basically what this tells us is that the spirit is going to exist apart from the body. Because what happened after they had died, the body of the criminal was thrown in a hole. The body of Jesus was placed in a tomb. But that day, both of the spirits went to paradise. Now, paradise actually was a part of Hades. Hades was split in two. You had the area for the blessed and the area for the wicked. After Jesus' resurrection, paradise was emptied, and the people there went to heaven. So that made a lot more room for the wicked to go. But yes, so now the saved are all in heaven from that part of Hades down there. The next verse says, Isaiah again, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. Second saying, this prophecy was fulfilled. Now, Jesus is on a cross. Can you imagine his mother walking up and seeing him up there? That had to have been terrible and heartbreaking, even though I'm sure why Jesus was here. But a mother to see their son suffering in such a way, it had to have been devastating. John the disciple was also at the cross with his mother Mary. Now, Jesus looked down and said, woman, behold your son. And then he told John, behold your mother. Now, calling his mother woman, there was nothing derogatory or demeaning about it. As a matter of fact, back in that time, calling your mother woman was highly respectful and affectionate. So there's nothing bad about it. What Jesus was telling John is that John basically became Mary's son at that point, and John took care of her from that point on. So that way, Mary was not left alone. She had John, which was her nephew, and Jesus' cousin. So from that point on, John took care of Mary. Remember, Mary is the woman whose seed is now crushing the head of the serpent. You remember from Genesis, the serpent's head will be bruised. This is the person who is now bruising the head of the serpent. With this particular saying, we can see sympathy because he is feeling sympathetic for his mother, who is now being left alone. He wanted to make sure that she was taken care of. With the next verse, out of Exodus, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land, which the Lord your God is giving you. Again, with Jesus saying this, this particular prophecy, once again, was fulfilled. It is now the sixth hour, which is noon. Darkness now falls over the land. Suddenly, it gets very dark. At this point, we hear Jesus cry. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, it was at this point that Jesus has taken on the sins of the world. All of the transgressions, all the sin over time is now placed on his shoulders. Can you imagine the weight of that? Jesus makes this cry because of the mental anguish he is feeling when this is suddenly laid on him. The crushing weight is now on his shoulders. But why did he cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was at this point. Remember, God cannot take sin. So God had to break his fellowship with Jesus in order for him to take on the sin of the world. But as he cried, "My God and not my Father," tells us that Jesus knew that even in this most awful time of mental anguish and feeling the crushing weight of our sins, that God was still with him. He didn't just abandon him. He was still there with him. In Psalm 22:1, it says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning?" This tells us, again, that this prophecy was fulfilled, almost word for word, that Jesus cried out. After a little while longer, Jesus says, "I thirst." Now, before Jesus was nailed to the cross, he was offered a drink, which some believe may be a painkiller that was offered to him, but he refused. He did not take it. Now, his thirst is caused by the fever that is raging within his body. Now, remember, this was the man who began his ministry by hungering. Now he is thirsting. This was the man who changed water into wine. Thirsty. This was the man who asked a Samaritan for a drink of water. He's now given vinegar by his enemies. The Apostle John believes this to mean, when he says, "I thirst," Jesus is thirsting after the salvation of the world. He is thirsting for the glorification of God. He's thirsting for the song of redemption. Because Jesus thirsted for us, we need to also thirst after God ourselves. We don't want to be caught in this predicament. In Revelation 6, 16 and 17, it's not going to come up on the screen up there. Basically, it tells us that if we do not believe in God, if we turn away from him, we're going to be caught in this. It says, "And I said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" So at that point of judgment, we may, hopefully we're not. We may not be there. Hopefully we're all not there. It could be that we're going to want to have the mountains fall on us. We want the rocks, so we're going to hide ourselves from judgment. Are we going to be able to stand before God in judgment and say, "I'm saved, I am here"? Are we? Or are we going to want to hide? I feel confident. I want to stand in front of God and say, "I'm here. Take me with you. I don't want a mountain to fall on me." So, no, do not want that to happen. Psalm 21. "They also gave me gall for my food, and for my thirst gave me vinegar to drink." Again, prophecy is fulfilled. Jesus, after a while, he's quiet. Finally, he says, "It is finished." Now, with this, because of the rage, Jesus could not speak. His throat was dry. When he said, "I thirst," and they gave him the vinegar basically cooled his throat enough to where he could speak and say, "It is finished." What this is Jesus' satisfaction with what he has accomplished. Remember, Jesus said, "It is the will of him that sent me." I'm sorry, "It is the meat of him that sent me to do his will and to finish his work." With this, Jesus is telling us that all of the prophecy that was forecast, all of the promises that were made, all that men had strived for through the ages was now finished. This was a cry of Jesus that was a cry of triumph in what seemed to be a moment of despair. So Jesus is crying out in triumph, "It is finished." This tells us that redemption is done. This is where Jesus is telling us we are now, his work is finished, we are now saved. They will come and declare his righteousness to a people who will be born, that he has done this. Again, this prophecy is fulfilled. It is finished. Finally, Jesus says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now, this is a joyful resignation of Jesus, that he is yielding up his spirit into the hands of his Father. It's not something to be sad. Jesus was happy that he can now go and be with his Father. This tells us, again, that the spirit is going to exist apart from the body in the hands of God. When Jesus passed away, there was an earthquake. The veil in the temple was split from the top to the bottom. Rocks were broken open. Graves that had been closed for years and had the saints in the graves, they were broken open. And saints that had fallen asleep for many, many years began walking the streets. Now, this just means that, again, resurrection is going to occur. The blessed are going to go up to heaven. The earth shook. Rocks were split. Now, this scripture shows that Jesus' end ministry was on his lips, because this was the last thing he passed away. Psalm 31:5. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth. Prophecy was fulfilled. Now, after Jesus had passed away, it says, so the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that had happened. They feared greatly, saying, truly, this is the Son of God. Now, in the theology class I'm attending, we actually looked at a report that was written by Pontius Pilate that Caesar Augustus required because of all the stuff that was going on in Judea. He wanted to know what was going on. So the report that Pilate had written to Caesar basically everything that Jesus had done. It talked about the miracles he performed, the people that he healed. It talked about the earth shaking that had scared all the Romans because they thought their God was mad at them, but not that God himself, the true God, had shaken the ground. So as you read through all of this stuff, at the very end was the thing that actually stuck out in my mind. The centurion's name was Malchus. And at the very end, Pilate states, I am almost ready to say, as did Malchus at the cross, truly, this was the Son of God. So even Pilate at the end believed that this was the Son of God. Do you know what happened after this? I thought he went on to Africa and actually became a priest or something in Africa. But as we learn later on, Pilate was summoned to Rome, and he was actually beheaded, which I didn't know that. I didn't know Pilate would ended his life that way. But before he died, he asked Jesus for forgiveness, to please forgive him for what he did. Are we going to see Pilate in heaven? Absolutely. He was sorry and regretted for putting an innocent man to death. So he did ask for that forgiveness. Okay, the next verse we're all very familiar with. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loves us. If he didn't, do you think he could have wiped us out and started over again? Kind of like he did with Noah? Absolutely. But God loved us enough to give us his only Son so that we can be saved and have everlasting life. Now, this doesn't have a lot of directions with it. It doesn't say I have to jump through this hoop and fly through that one or fall over this or anything like that. It gives me one instruction. Believe in him so we should not perish. It's a very simple instruction. We must believe in Jesus Christ. Now, what I'd like for you to do is, or give you the chance, if you like to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, I would like to say a salvation prayer with you. This way we are sure that we are going to go to heaven when my time comes. I want to make sure I'm going to go there just in case something happens to me on the way home today. That if something happens, I'm going that way and not the other way. If you said the salvation prayer and you are saved and you want to follow along just because you want to make sure, that's fine. You can either say it out loud with me, you can say it within the quietness of your own heart. That is fine. I would just like for everybody to please close your eyes, put your head down. Dear Lord, I admit that I am a sinner. I have done many things that do not please you. I am sorry and I repent. I ask you to forgive me. I believe that you died on the cross for me to save me. You did what I could not do for myself. Help me to live every day in a way that pleases you. I love you, Lord, and I thank you that I will spend all eternity with you. Amen. If you said that prayer for the first time and you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, welcome to the Excellent. All right. When I say I'm going to wrap up, I'm going to wrap up. I'm not going to run on another 20 minutes. So, Pastor Steve, is there anything you want to say before we dismiss? Talking about Sam last week. Go ahead. Great, thank you. All right, y'all stand up. Give you the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. May he give you his countenance and bring you peace. For you are blessed in the city and you are blessed in the field. You are blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear?
Nobody.
Go in peace. Thank you.